9th Annual Weissberg Lecture on International Human Rights. I'm Beth Dougherty. I'm on the Weissberg Committee and teach political science here at the college. I'd like to recognize tonight the generous support of our benefactors, the Weissberg Foundation, and specifically Marvin Weissberg, a proud Beloit parent, and Nina Weissberg, class of 1984, and also a member of our Board of Trustees. None of this would be possible without Marvin and Nina's vision and commitment to the college. The mission of the Weissberg Program in Human Rights is to prepare Beloit College students to engage critically with human rights and to develop effective and responsible strategies that promote and defend human dignity. We'd also like to recognize tonight a group of alumni who initiated the visit of tonight's speaker, as well as supported his visit financially. So we'd like to acknowledge and thank Sue Law, class of 1988, Dan Spaulding, class of 1986, Megan Hoover, class of 2006, and Michael Simon, class of 1988, and Carol Simon, class of 1982. Thank you so much for your efforts in making tonight possible. In addition to today's annual forum on human rights, this April we'll welcome the college's 18th Weissberg Chair in International Studies, Eskinder Nagash, who is the Senior Vice President for Global Engagement for the United States Committee for Refugees and Immigrants. So please look out for the programming notes about that in the spring. Now I'd like to introduce tonight's esteemed speaker. Dr. Tamás Meszerics has served since 2014 as a member of the European Parliament as part of the Greens European Free Alliance. He is a Hungarian historian and politician who earned his master's degree and his PhD at Loránd Eötvös University in Budapest and held fellowships at the University of Leeds and George Mason University. Dr. Meszerics' fields of interest are theories of democracy, historical and theoretical studies of intelligence, bureaucracy, the history of modern Central European countries, and behavioral game theory. In 2011, he was a visiting scholar at the Minda de Gunzburg Center for European Studies at Harvard. A number of Beloit College alumni who benefited from Dr. Meszerics' knowledge and insights as students of his in the Beloit College Hungary Seminar. So any students who are attending tonight's talk who are inspired to study abroad in Hungary, or who were inspired by our panel earlier this afternoon to study abroad in Africa, for example, your applications are welcome at the Office of International Education, either on the November 1st deadline or the February 1st deadline. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Tamás Meszerics.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, first of all, allow me to thank the Weissberg Foundation and the Weissberg Program on Human Rights for having me here. It's a great honor for me to be able to speak at Beloit College. The idea comes from Sue Law, so she has been already thanked, but I would like to thank her once again. This was a great idea. I already had a great day, and I very much hope that you would enjoy the next hour so much as I did enjoy the entire day with you. With the generous introduction, you know the basics about me. You may not know why I would want to talk about human rights. In academia, I'm a sort of a jack of all trades, so I've been teaching all and sundry courses in political science, not anything on human rights. However, my interests in the European Parliament are mostly tied to the Foreign Affairs Committee. I'm a full member of the Foreign Affairs Committee, and you may be interested to know that actually the European Parliament and especially the Foreign Affairs Committee is actively engaged in actually promoting, defending, and highlighting human rights issues all around the world. So from all the, I just checked my own website before I did this, from all the 52 parliamentary resolutions that I initiated or seconded, 36 were on human rights related issues. That doesn't make me an expert on human rights, but that makes me a concerned person on human rights. And I think that's title enough to speak to you on human rights and how I see it. The specific title of this talk is whether human rights commitments constrain foreign policy? This is a vague and broad and very general sort of a question, and I give you the punchline, they do, but that is not the end of the story. Well, first of all, I'd like to speak a little about how I see human rights and what is the role of that in the international arena, in the life of the international community. So the first message that I would want you to take from this is that human rights are either universal or they just don't exist. This is a fact about human rights for which you can make a lengthy philosophical argument. And this is a fact about human rights which is actually frequently challenged. Not necessarily by those who do not want to support human rights, but there is a conception around which I'm facing as a politician and sometimes in academia as well, that, well, actually human rights may be important, but this is very much a contextual, culture-related, or specifically positive law-dependent phenomenon. Now, the news about this, that those who make this argument about the cultural relativity of human rights, and I'm borrowing an argument from a distinguished defender of human rights, Thomas Karothas, who is a frequent visitor to my home university, the Central European University, and I don't think he would mind if I call him a friend. He is the vice president of the Carnegie Endowment for human rights and democracy programs. So he would make the very simple argument that somehow you never come across persons from different cultures, from vulnerable or oppressed groups who would argue that they don't have human rights because that's cultural dependent and their culture just don't support human rights. When you get that, that's usually from the beneficiaries of the elite who are not willing to concede that they have an obligation to observe the human rights of those groups. This is one curious fact about the cultural dependence of human rights. But there is a more general argument which I would make from my own experience, and for me it is historically validated, so nobody can take that away from me. Namely that human rights is an upshot of a very fundamental basic equality of human beings, and that is the equal human dignity that we all possess as humans. If we acknowledge that, as all monotheistic religions do acknowledge that, as most political philosophy trends acknowledge that, then it inescapably follows that there should be an upshot from this fundamental equality of human beings. This equality does not depend on culture. This equality does not depend on race. This equality does not depend on any kind of preference human beings have. This simply follows from the fact that they are human beings and there are things that cannot be done to them. If this was not so, then I would have found myself in a completely impossible situation way back in the 1980s when actually we met with the first Beloit group. Namely, I would have had to acknowledge that it is just a question of my then government, which was a late socialist communist government, whether they are willing to extend some rights to me or not. And I would have felt considerably constrained by that view. I instinctively felt, and then I found the philosophical arguments for it, that this just cannot be the case. I either have human rights as a human being, or human rights don't exist at all. All we have is just the rights accrued by positive law to us. And that simply cannot be the case if we take seriously this fundamental equal dignity of human beings. So this is the philosophical part of the argument. So one of the fundamental facts about human rights is that they are universal, they are meant to be universal, and they cannot be understood unless they are understood to be universal. The second point that I'm going to make is related to the international dimension of this. Human rights regimes across the board in international law and in general in international politics are under stress now. They are strained. They have challenges left, right, and center in many regions of the world. This is not the best time for human rights defenders. This is not a period of one of the biggest success stories. New illiberal powers portray human rights activists as advocates of all sorts of and sponsors of human rights as all sorts of people violating the principle of non-intervention, that they are actually actively engaged in illegitimate international intervention into the affairs of other states. This is one of the oldest arguments made against human rights activism and human rights concerns in international relations. And of course, the basic principle of international law of non-intervention is true, but what it constrains and what it prohibits is direct state intervention. Even that is conditioned on a number of facts. It's never an absolute principle in international law. Those who have started to study international law would probably know that all principles of international law are equally important, and none of them are completely universally valid all the time in all situations. Mind you, if you are interested in how human rights and humanitarian law enters into international law, you can do much worse than actually study Stephen Neff's wonderful book, Justice Among Nations. It's available in your library. I checked it out yesterday. So do that if you're interested in the story. Even if you are not planning a career in law, it's a readable, single volume, very interesting book on the development of international law. So one of the arguments these illiberal countries and their leaders make, most famous among them is Vladimir Putin, but he's not the only one, is that this is a new form of intervention, that this is nothing other than imperialism on behalf of some other powers, most notably usually the United States, but not restricted to the United States. The strains put on international human rights activism is partly due also to the fact that the space for civil society has been shrinking constantly in the post-Soviet sphere, and that's a large chunk of the modern world. This is not a good time to be whatever NGO you're working for, from Tajikistan till Belarus, and even in moderately interesting cases like Armenia. So there is a shrinking space for civil society, which reduces the chances for human rights activists, obviously, in the region. Now, however, the silver lining of all these in all these attacks and strains on the human rights regime that we have already in international law, which is a non-binding part of international law, but nevertheless an important part of international law, that the enemies of human rights or the challengers of human rights now are not making the argument that that human rights do not exist. The argument they're putting forward is somewhat different. It's either that it is cultural dependent and their culture is somehow not amenable to a few of these. If we entertain the thought of an international system in which individual states and leaders of individual states are allowed to cherry pick which of the rights they're willing to concede to their subjects, this is going to be an international world considerably different from the current modern world. This will bring us back to the 18th or maybe to the 17th century, which was not a very good time period for humans to live in, especially in Europe at that time. So one of the arguments they make is that human rights exist, but they are fully culture dependent and their culture is not hospitable to all of them. The second argument they make is, as I already mentioned, that human rights and reference to human rights is actually some part of a foreign plot to undermine the sovereignty of the state. These are the two crucial arguments, and the silver lining, as I say in this, that none of this denies the existence of the human rights or even the importance of the human rights. The things that you attack most in a most sort of determined fashion is usually the thing which is important for you and important for others as well. So this is the silver lining. Defending and promoting civil rights is just not just the task of states, not just the task of international organizations like the United Nations and many others, actually. It requires and has always required a full engagement and strong engagement of individual civil activists in civil society networks. Unless there are people willing to engage with that at the international level, this is not going to work. Human rights should be a concern for everyone because these are universal. So whenever human rights are violated anywhere, your rights are also violated at the same time. The second lesson from which I would want to draw from this for you is that this sort of activism, this sort of engagement with human rights internationally is first of all a must for actually maintaining any meaningful human rights regime, and secondly, it fundamentally resembles diplomacy. This is a weird parallel, I know, but it requires the very same skills. In fact, it relies heavily on those types of skills for which not everybody is fully suited, but which you can learn even if you're not that type of person. First of all, it requires that sort of ability for intercultural communication, which is the requirement for the best diplomats, and also a requirement for international human rights activists. You should be able to empathize with a different culture and still carry the message that there are fundamental values that we actually share even if we are in different cultures. That's a tough task. That's a communication skill you need to learn, and I'm fully aware, I was aware before my visit, but I'm now, after a day here, I'm fully aware that many of you already share that kind of skill, sharing that skill, and you have the opportunity here to practice that skill at Beloit College. The other important skill which is required both by diplomats and human rights activists internationally is basically the personality trait or skill, depending on how you look at it, of patience. Both diplomacy and this sort of activism requires enormous amounts of patience. You have to go through the very same motions time and again without having the absolute certainty that the next day or a week from now or a year from now that will actually bear fruit. Take the case of individual human rights violations and support, for example, of political prisoners in different countries. The things human rights activists do is the same thing that diplomats do in this case. Turn to the authorities, draw their attention, highlight the issue, keep the name visible, keep the person visible to the larger public without necessarily having the certainty that this will ever work. But once you have this patience, it usually bears fruit. In fact, there are more powerful and less powerful agents in this, but the success rate doesn't depend directly on the amount of power you can bring to the question. It really depends on to the amount of dedication and patience you can bring to this question. So this is already the second thing that diplomats and human rights activists share. And thirdly, diplomats and human rights activists alike must be attuned to talking to power in a way which is not directly offensive, but nevertheless consistent and strong enough to carry a message. This is probably the toughest skill of all, the most difficult to learn. You need some experience for that. But this is, again, a trait that the best diplomats and the best human rights activists do actually share. You should be able to talk to power without lecturing others on how you should behave, but at the same time carrying the message that there are these values and violations are just wrong and you should do something about it. So lesson number two from this is that actually diplomats and human rights activists share a number of the necessary traits for their work to being successful. And actually, the mode of operation of diplomacy and the mode of operation of international human rights activism is almost exactly the same, except as civil rights activists, you're not representing governments. You're representing humanity, for that matter. So in some sense, it's a much more elevated position than whatever you can achieve in diplomacy. The third point, and I'm now turning to the original question I put at the beginning of this little talk, is how human rights as an international concern affect the foreign policy of states. Well, again, if you turn to Stephen Neff's wonderful book, you would learn that basically the upsurge of human rights commitments in the international arena by states came in two waves. First one in the late 40s, basically after the Second World War with the creation of the United Nations, and secondly in the 1970s. Those were sort of the heydays of humanitarian international law and human rights concerns of foreign policy in general. But the phenomenon is much older than that. Some of you may be familiar with the story of William Wilberforce, the late 18th, early 19th century British Member of Parliament and one of the first and one of the most patient and most effective human rights activists. He was the one who, through patient work, through campaigning and his parliamentary work, after 20 years of failure, succeeded in abolishing, almost single-handedly succeeded in abolishing slave trade in the British realm. Now, if there is a genuine international human rights concern, there is. That is one. So, I cannot advise you for anything better than read one of the many different biographies available of William Wilberforce. The most recent one is written by William Hague, former British Foreign Secretary. It's an enjoyable single volume story of William Wilberforce. If you want to spare time, you can watch the brilliant movie about Wilberforce named Amazing Grace. It's a 2006 very nice movie about the story, which would give you the basics actually in those types of skills, what you need for this. And the first of them, among them, is really patience. Sometimes it can take decades, but when it bears fruits, it's one of the biggest things in history. So, even if it goes back to the 18th century, early 19th century, this sort of engagement is a fairly recent phenomenon in international law and in international politics. However, even with that short history in the background, there are already states who at least who form at least part of their identity in the international arena based their role in the international system based on human rights promotion. There are many important examples for that. Just take the case of Norway, which happens to be the single largest per capita GDP donor of international aid and a standard concern with human rights and international humanitarian law. It is part of the identity of Norwegian foreign policy that they are doing this. This is their role in the international system. Similarly, to a slightly different degree, the European Union is one such actor. In the founding treaties of the European Union, human rights and promotion of human rights universally is among the core values of the European Union. Now, the European Union is not necessarily very effective in that compared its weight economically. But in fact, it is its economic weight allows the European Union to have a significant voice, even when it is talking about seemingly minor issues, for example, individual political prisoners. I was lucky enough to witness the case of Leyla Yunus, an Azeri human rights activist, human rights lawyer, actually, who has been imprisoned wrongfully. At least she was a political prisoner, and after repeated resolutions, partly from coming from the European Parliament, some of which I had the honor of authoring, she was at least released by the Azeri authorities when they realized that this can again can seriously hurt their business interest with the European Union. So there are important international actors who actually form their identity about around the question of human rights and human rights promotion. Now, but does this restrict their freedom of action in international politics and international diplomacy? This is usually the claim the adherents of realism in international relations make, that this is either a sham or downright silly, because no state should take up voluntarily those types of commitments which would restrict its future freedom of action in all sorts of environment, because ultimately what you need to follow as the primary state actor in the international arena is your own individual state interest. That's what matters. Everything else is either a sham or a mistake. I have many problems with classical realism in international relations. Not that it's not a worthy theory. It is something that you should learn about, you should take seriously if you study international relations theory. But the fact is that commitments taken up voluntarily by actors in any setting, be it political, social, interpersonal, are actually limiting your future scope of action. No question about that. Whatever commitment you take up, it means that you actually promise to adhere to it in the future. Therefore, you're not free to do anything else if that is at stake. All sorts of commitments are usually restrictive in this particular fundamental sense. But is this a problem? This is the message, the third message that I want you to take away from this short talk, that this is not necessarily a problem. In fact, adherence to commitments that you take up voluntarily produces one of the most important phenomena in international relations, as much as in interpersonal relations. It generates a perception of reliability. And unless you have that, your freedom of action may be very large, but actually nobody is going to take you very seriously. Reliability comes from commitments that you make, commitments that actually you willingly take to constrain your future set of actions. And commitment to human rights is one of these types of commitments. You are going to be perceived to be reliable on that score. And reliability is, to use this very abstract theoretical language, is a transitive value. Once you prove to be reliable in one area, you are usually perceived to be reliable in other areas as well. And this is a capital asset in international relations. Those states that are perceived to be fully reliable are usually taken much more seriously in all situations. This is why, for example, although I had no real issues with the Obama administration, the case in Syria was a very serious case. Not because of the non-intervention in Syria. That is something you can argue about. That's a question partly of politics, partly of security, partly of all sorts of global concerns. But stating that you would want to draw a red line and then doing nothing about it is the worst that you can do, because that takes away this perception of reliability. It takes away the perception that you are able to fulfill your own commitments. And from then on, it would be much more difficult to re-enter any of these issues, re-enter the international arena as a reliable power. So the ultimate message is that yes, it constrains, but for the better. And this is all that I wanted to say tonight, and I'm open to all sorts of questions related to the talk or whatever you're interested in. Thank you very much. I'm not sure I want to moderate the thing, but please.
Yep. There's one question, yeah, please.
Well,
you know, one thing that I'm kind of curious about is whether you think that the, as you say, this is not a good time necessarily for human rights activists, but do you think that the state of human rights in general in the US and in Europe has improved in the last, say, 20 years, or are we on a downward slope?
That partly depends on which definition of human rights you are adhering to. And this, I deliberately did not talk about that. That has been a debated issue ever since the notion of human rights have entered the political discourse in Europe or in the United States. So if you have an extensive view of what human rights consist in, then you would be able to notice a decline in that. If you have a more restrictive view on what human rights consist in, then you would rather argue that no, it's not human rights which have been in a declining trend, but rather the imperfections of democracy have enlarged. So it's more about the political process than necessarily about rights. I don't want to adjudicate between those two views. That really depends on fundamental commitments, theoretical commitments that you may have in international law or in human rights law in general. But either of them, or at least one of them, should be true. And this explains why we have problems both in Europe and in the United States with the political process. Either you label it as imperfections of democracy, imperfections of the political system, or you label it some sort of deterioration of the human rights situation. Both are equally worrying. So whichever view you take, you should be worried about that. Yes, please.
Okay. Thank you for your chat. I'm the exchange student from South Korea, so I want to ask about the empathy. So how do you think, what is empathy, and how can you do empathize? Because, for example, about the North Korea, I think we need to something actions about the weak human rights to the North Korea, because they need to the conception of the human rights. But even we can touch them. And in the North Korea, we can talk with the North Korean people, and we need to something actions, but we can't. So kind of we have limits. And in this situation, how can we emphasize that people with that culture?
Well, first of all, this is a fundamentally different world than it used to be, say, 20 years ago or 30 years ago, in terms of what information, what specific amount of information you can get. Even for a very closed country like North Korea, if you want to know, you can know much more about it than any of the late socialist countries in the mid to late 80s. So information is available. One of the fundamental requirements for empathy is basic knowledge about the political system, the society, and the basics of the culture. Coming from South Korea, understanding the fundamental culture should present no problem. What presents the problem is understanding how the political process works and how you could have an engagement with that political process. That's a tough one. Most diplomats have sort of cracked on that one for decades by now. But as I try to argue, this is not a justification for not doing anything about it. There are still a number of international fora to which sooner or later North Korea would be in need of listening to. This is not a long-term sustainable regime. We know about these regimes that they are very much dependent on a particular political elite, sometimes on a particular set of persons for their maintenance. And once that is gone, the situation would be fundamentally different. And those fora, international fora that are available actually to international human rights activists could become very important in a matter of days. So actually making your voice heard in those fora, maybe that's would not yield direct results in North Korea just now, but that is a requirement for when the opening comes to have a serious engagement on the basis of a serious sort of really thought through commitment to human rights and not just precarious state interests of various sorts in the region and outside of it. So there are fora. At this point you cannot talk directly to the North Korean regime. You can, but it's usually futile. But there are fora on which you can register these types of claims, and those are going to be heard sooner or later.
Yes.
Okay, so thank you for your lecture. I think now refugees are kind of like a serious problem in European countries. So what is your idea about refugees in Bolivia and the beginning to the human rights? What do you think about refugees and how should the countries treat them?
Well, this is in some sense a very simple question. There is a body of international law regulating how states should treat refugees. There are the Geneva conventions about refugees, and there is a large body of international law. The problem is not, at this point, what creates the crisis is not the recognition that there are refugees who are in need of some sort of international protection. The problem is, at this point, the large influx in a very short period of time into one particular area, namely the European Union. Not even the numbers. It is the swiftness and the size of the wave which generated the problems. And unfortunately, this gave rise to very nasty and, I think, unpardonable populist politics in important parts of Europe. My country is not exempt from that, unfortunately. And I'm sorry to say that, because I would like to see my country being a champion of human rights and working actively for a redefinition of European refugee policies. The problem is not insoluble in any sense. It is just that all sorts of other concerns has been dumped on as if it was directly related to the refugee question. Most of the real issues that Europe is facing with integration of various minorities, among them primarily Muslim minorities in various countries, is not directly related to the refugee question. There's a problem of integration. We don't exactly know what works and what doesn't work in different parts of Europe. But instead of dealing with that and reviewing that sort of situation, everybody's concentrating on the refugee issue. There are already 50 million Muslims in Europe. That is 10% of the population of the entire continent. That's a sizable minority. Now, if by some miracle, and I'm not advocating that, but if by some miracle somebody would be able to close down all the external borders of the European Union tomorrow, hermetically, nobody out or in, that would still not solve any of the problems related to the questions of integration. Muslim radicalization would still be a phenomenon. Terrorism related to that radicalization would still be an open question. It's not a direct, there is no direct causal link between the refugee situation now and the resurgence of extreme Islamist ideology in many parts of Europe. So in fact, we are obscuring the real issues with highlighting the refugee problem in Europe, and I think that that is a misleading and fundamentally confusing position. I very much hope, based on historical experience so far, that populist politics is not a lasting phenomenon. It's a kind of a surge type of phenomenon. It has its upsurge, but it dies out almost as quickly as it went up. The bad news is that sometimes it is enough to put people into offices. And that's why you have to live with the long-term consequences. And that's a worrying part of the story. I'm not sure whether that satisfies your question or not.
I was just wondering, if human rights are universal and sort of every single human has these rights, you can't ask everyone what rights you have universally. So how do we decide what are the universal human rights and who gets to decide that?
Cool. This is the fundamental debate that has been going on ever since the 18th century, ever since the Enlightenment. This is an evolving story. For the time being, it seems that the overall trend is the expansion of the realm of human rights. Newer and newer phenomena are classified as rights-related or falling directly under the category of human rights. There are innocuous examples that you would very easily understand how this evolution works. Say, in the 1920s, so 100 years ago, absolutely well-meaning, benevolent educator could seriously believe that corporal punishment is part of the education process. It's a necessary part of it. That was part of the general consensus basically all around the world. Now you would recognize it as direct abuse, as violating some fundamental rights of children and young people. That it is just an unthinkable claim. And it was an absolutely consensual position 100 years ago. So this is the type of evolution. You just recognize that there are sorts of conflicts which you are actually willing to see as being about rights and not just being about interest or being about well-being directly. Nevertheless, this is always part of the political debate. You cannot just adjudicate it, so to speak. There is no legislative solution to identifying what human rights are. This is part of politics. This is one of the most important parts of politics, identifying what kind of rights we have, what should fall under this universal phenomenon, and what should be left out of it. So I cannot give you an absolutely objective list of what counts as human rights. I know about the more or less current, more or less broad consensus, but this is always part of the political contest, and it should be. Please.
I was wondering, you mentioned earlier how often illiberal regimes use the excuse of like a violation of sovereignty against human rights activism, and it can be seen as like neo-imperialism. So I was interested in hearing a little bit more about how human rights can be implemented without it becoming neo-imperialistic.
I think if you're serious about it and if your engagement is actually with the fundamental values and the fundamental rights, it is just simply not imperialism. As I told you, this is the favorite example coming from Thomas Carruthers. Those people whose rights, general universal human rights, are violated in these kinds of societies rarely claim that this is all right because we have a different culture. They just don't have voice. And somebody has to give them voice. It's best if it's those activists, those individuals engaged within that society. But sometimes their work is actually made impossible by the authorities. As I said, in much of the post-Soviet space, generally the space for any sort of civil society activism is shrinking. Now it is in much of Central Asia, it's only about charitable work and nothing else. Only about providing for the old or the ill, actually taking over some of the tasks of the state from them and provide basic healthcare support. But that doesn't mean that nobody has the right to point out that actually, for example, child labor is a violation of fundamental human rights. Somebody has to say that. We do that in the European Parliament quite regularly. And if there are no agents within those countries, then it's us. It's others coming from the outside. If it is treated as any kind of imperialism, as sort of imposing alien values on them, this is a political ploy. It is very often successful in the short term, but sooner or later, that type of activism would find its way in these societies as well. There is just no way that constant and recurring violations of human rights would remain unnoticed or unmentioned by people in those societies as well. You have allies. Most of the time, the worst that can happen is that they are silenced. But you actually do have allies in these countries. And this is something you should, if you are engaged with this, this is something you should be fully aware of and keep in mind constantly. You're not an alien power imposing something on them. You have allies. Maybe you have a difficult time actually identifying and finding them, but they're there. Please.
I wonder if you could tell us more about your own career in Hungary, because the current regime in Hungary is one of those you mentioned.
Yes.
That seems to be backtracking on democracy and not human rights. And if I remember correctly, there's heavy criticism of people like yourself within Hungary, within the domestic political context. Have you faced interference or criticism at home for your activities in the European Parliament?
Well, political criticism, yes. Nothing that I wouldn't be able to survive. So, in some sense, being called a traitor by some of those closer to the authorities is a badge of honor. So I don't really I don't really mind that. And no, it's not that risky. So I don't want to claim any kind of a sort of personal risk involved in making those types of claims or making my voice heard about backtracking of democracy in Hungary. It's not threatening my career in any important sense. To that degree, it is still a more or less working half democracy, that you're not going to necessarily have individual risks involved with this. Of course, coming from a private university in my civilian life, I'm in a privileged position, and I'm fully aware of that. It would be very different if my career or livelihood would depend on the government in any important way. That would be a much more vulnerable position. And many of my friends back home are in exactly that position. They are the ones whom we should be worried about, and I should be worried about, not me. I'm in a very privileged position, so I can live with that.
In your professional opinion, what do you think is going to be the outcome of Duarte's mass killing, over 2,000 criminals to happen? Because at some point it's going to come to an end. What is going to be the result of what's been going on?
Ideally, an international criminal court would be the solution to that. Unfortunately, one of the most important opponents of that idea is the United States, for all sorts of historical and political and legal, sort of domestic legal reasons. If there was a working international criminal court, that would be an obvious case that could be brought to that international criminal court. The ideas are not that new, they're relatively old. Already 30 years ago, there were serious sort of legal preparations for creating such a court. And I think this will come. This is something which will become unavoidable sooner or later if there is this fundamental view, which is still shared in a large segment of what we usually call the West, that human rights are related to these fundamental human values and therefore universal. It is unavoidable that systematic and large-scale human rights violations should count as a crime, and should count as a crime in international law. So I just very much hope that once there is a working international criminal court, one of the first cases could be a Duarte case.
Yes. So I kind of want to ask a little more about the previous question. Like, why is it, you tell us a little bit more about why is it in the United States' interest that we allow what's going on in the Philippines to continue?
If you put it that way, I don't know the answer. I don't know. I think the opposite would be in the interest of the United States. But at the same time, I have some understanding for the fact that being still the largest power in the world and having a very limited attention span, both in terms of time and in terms of energy, actually asks for prioritizing. Prioritizing is anyway one of the standard tenets or requirements in politics. If prioritizing is actually working against upholding the international human rights regime by just turning away from these issues, then that is wrong. I think that is not in the interest of the United States or any serious power in the international arena. So this is my short. It's not in the interest of the United States just to turn turn a blind eye on that particular story. If you ask the other way around, why would it be in the interest of the United States to be concerned with and to deal with an ongoing issue in the Philippines, then the answer is, if you want the value-based answer, is because it is about universal human rights. And if it's not the greatest power on the face of Earth who should be dealing with this, who else? As simple as that. Of course, if there was a workable, reliable, international system of human rights enforcement, be it through the UN or some other international agency, that would be a much easier position for everyone, but that's just not yet on the horizon.
Please.
Leaving aside the whole issue of Syrian refugees, what do you see as the major human rights issues that are really important to Europe now?
Well, some of them are internal. There are still human rights issues, even in member states. More so in the immediate neighborhood, be it the eastern neighborhood of the European Union or the southern neighborhood of the European Union. And some of the most dramatic violations of human rights are actually happening in countries which we consider as allies. Saudi Arabia is a case in point. It's considered to be, well, not as much as, say, 10 years ago, but still considered to be one of the most reliable allies in the Arab world, both for the United States and for the European Union. And it has a horrendous record of human rights violations for the last 10 years, and actually on a quite large scale. So it's not just isolated phenomena. It's actually part of the Saudi political process, so to speak. And we have examples of that across the board, around the periphery of the European Union. But there are some in the European Union itself. Take the case of prison conditions. That is usually related to the observation or denial of fundamental human rights of inmates. And the situation is very, very varied across the European Union. There are countries where you wouldn't want to even to imagine that you're put in prison. And those are members of the European Union. And there are similar issues across the board. And there are the fundamental gender-related human rights issues, or the sexual preference-related human rights issues. We are still struggling with the idea, for example, of gay rights in some of the candidate members, or even in some of the member states of the European Union, despite the fact that non-discrimination is one of the fundamental tenets enshrined in the European treaties. So there's a lot to be done within the European Union as well, but there is a worrying and large-scale violation of human rights on the periphery, in the immediate neighborhood of the European Union. And if we are not responsible for that, who is?
Please.
Yeah, how realistic is an institution that actually enforces international law?
Realistic in the sense of being possible or realistic in the sense of now having political support behind it? If in the latter, then it's not realistic at the moment. But political support is a very transitory phenomenon. It can be created. It can emerge in very surprising ways. Again, the case in point is actually the story of William Wilberforce. Just check that. If there were powerful interest against abolishing the slave trade from Britain, abolishing it on British vessels, that was the second biggest industry of Great Britain at the time he started his campaign. 20 years later, he got almost a unanimous vote in Westminster abolishing the slave trade completely. So the fact that you don't observe political support for a particular institution or a particular regime, rights regime, is not a good indicator of anything about the future. These political phenomena can change, and they can change surprisingly quickly. So if it's realistic in terms of being possible and being imaginable without reinventing an entirely different world, it is realistic. If the question is whether it is likely to happen tomorrow, it's not.
Could you talk a little bit about climate change and sort of its position relative to human rights and whether you have sort of advice for human rights activists in sort of addressing it?
That's a complex issue. I wouldn't want just to break it down to human rights concern, although there are implications for the viability and sustainability of actually human rights regimes in those areas actually directly affected by climate change. And regrettably, the geographic areas most likely to be affected very adversely and very quickly by even a moderate change in climate are exactly the poorest regions of the world. It's sub-Saharan Africa, it's some of Southeast Asia. Those are going to be the societies most affected by climate change and very, very, very quickly. The bad news is that this is not some, even though there is a seemingly better trend, we are running against the clock and nobody knows exactly. There are various estimates that it's already the 24th hour, but even if it is not the time span, the window of opportunity for concerted efforts is very, very limited. Now, the human rights ramifications of all this is that, of course, one of the primary results from massive climate change in the poorest regions of the world would be a massive additional migration. It's in some sense absolutely unavoidable because simply those areas will become inhospitable, maybe in a time of a few decades. Already, in fact, the Arab Peninsula is unlivable, and 500 years ago that was a quasi-Mediterranean area. I think I'm preaching to the choir here, so I don't think there are serious people in this room who would want to deny the fact that climate change is actually occurring. So it's not just a theoretical possibility, it is actually occurring. Witness your own climate. I mean, 6 years ago, a hurricane in Chicago would have been unthinkable. And this is, I'm not saying it's a daily phenomenon, but every second year you have serious storms approaching hurricane proportions in Chicago, up in the north. If it is not related to climate change, then to what? So this is not the issue. The issue is what you can do about it. And this is very, very complex, very complicated, requires much of the nature of expertise, which I don't personally possess, so I don't want to pretend that I know the detailed answers to what sort of international policy regimes would be able to alleviate, not even to stop, the effect. My gravest concern, however, is that even if we fundamentally reorient international development aid and make it much more effective, the current problem with international development aid is not the volume. The volume is also part of the problem, but the biggest problem is that it doesn't reach those affected on the ground. It dissipates somehow in the process, mostly in the forms of direct corruption across the board in these countries. Even if you could solve that very quickly and you find a reliable international development aid regime which would be able to reach the directly affected population, in fact what it would do in the first place, and you should be prepared for that, is that it would actually contribute to migration. There are areas on the face of Earth now where people would want to move away. The reason why they can't move is because they are in abject poverty. So the first effective aid reaches those regions, those people start to move. And we should be prepared for that. We should be preparing for even larger scale migration. But that is something with which humankind has lived ever since we have written history. So migration is not the problem. It's, in fact, a symptom. The problems are more fundamental. The problems are that we are overusing the natural resources of the planet by almost two times every year right now on. And that is not, obviously, not sustainable in the long run. I'm not sure whether this is a satisfactory answer, but I don't have the general answer to that. Please.
Go for the evening.
Within societies and countries, would you say that the presence of human rights violations tends to be correlated with the degree of absence of religious freedom, or correlated with the degree of religious persecution?
I'm not entirely sure about a general universal correlation, but in many societies that is a fact. So human rights violations are related to denial of all sorts of freedoms of expression, among them freedom of worship as well. This is not, however, again, not culture specific. In all sorts of cultures, with all sorts of dominant religions, you would have human rights violations and you could have significant restrictions on freedom of worship. So I'm not sure about the universal correlation, but the sad fact is that when there, in societies where there are large-scale systematic violations of human rights, they're usually not just on one single batch of human rights, but on the whole spectrum.
I'd like to thank all of you for coming. Please join me in thanking Dr. Meszerics.
Thank you.